Hello, everyone. Hello, Lisa.
Hello.
Thank you so much for joining us here for the Tuesday Talks and also for our podcast listeners. So thanks for being here with us. Lisa is one of my leadership tribe mates and a fellow mama in this space. And I am so happy to have you on. So thank you so much.
I'm really happy to be here.
Yeah. So can you give people just like a little bit of background about you and your story, just so they know a little bit more about you?
Yeah, of course. I started in the corporate world I live in Canada, Toronto, and I started in the corporate world, spent about 17 years there, had three kids in the midst of all that. And ended up leaving about a year after having my third, in search of something new that would light up the fire in my belly again. And I like to say I'm an accidental coach because I came about it by accident and it lit up the fire. And here I am a few years later, coaching leaders in the corporate world, entrepreneurs, people trying to juggle life as we all do.
Oh yeah. Especially right now. So yes, definitely. Yeah, totally. Today we're going to talk about motherhood and moms and kind of what are the stories that are going on right now about that. Sort of maybe some reframes around some of that stuff. And just an exploration about it. So one of the things that I really love about our relationship is that I really, really view you as this very, very professional mom. Like that's the image that I hold inside of myself about you. And it's so interesting because, you know, I was a full-time stay-at-home mom for 6 years. So I think that there's like a richness in our relationship that that I really love. I love how we kind of have some different life experience that's there, that's possible.
Yeah, no, for sure. I think we first connected over talking about motherhood.
Yeah, I think
that's what first brought us together, and I was sharing some of the challenges that, you know, parenthood and motherhood bring in general. And we both have three kids. You're about 2 years ahead of me, I think.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And so I was really intrigued by some of your philosophies on motherhood and parenthood. And I think we just had fun both talking about the challenges as well as kind of learning from each other in terms of how we approach it.
Yeah, I love this. And I remember that conversation too. And it was, you know what I felt about that conversation afterwards, looking back on it? Maybe at some point in the middle of the conversation, I remember having this feeling where I was like, this super professional woman like wants to hear about my like mom experience stuff, like that's crazy. And it was definitely a shift inside of me too. And I think it's a really cool place to go because I think that there are some funky stories and some funky things that are going on right now in society between women who choose to be sort of, I don't know how to say this. Well, this is a frame that I'm putting on it. Women who choose to be part-time moms. So who part of the time of their day, they are doing something other than mothering children. And part of the day, they are doing something that is mothering their children. There's like a tension between that and then the women who choose to be full-time moms and have that be at least a part of their career progression. And I feel like there's so much tension there and there's weirdness there. And when I talk to groups of women, there's something that's going on right there that I think is very interesting.
It's interesting because I can say that I have always had a real respect for full-time moms and parents who decide to stay at home. We're seeing a lot more men doing this as well than I did even 12 years ago when I had my first, right? I remember on maternity leave, walking around Toronto, and you'd not see a lot of men on paternity leave or parental leave. And by my third, you saw many more, right? Still predominantly female, but I can feel the shift there, right? Yeah. What I realized when I became a mom was that all of the skills that made me a good leader were exponentially required at home. And so I love being a mom. I love being a parent. And at times, work was an escape from the challenge and the 24/7 demands and requirements of being a parent. And I think now, with so much of the world at home trying to balance parenthood and working, or so many people have also lost their jobs and now are parenting 100% or 100% of the time, they're realizing how challenging parenting actually is. And I would say, in terms of EQ, the requirements that have been needed of me as a mother have exponentially increased my EQ.
I totally agree with that. I so agree with this. And this is definitely something that I am working really hard to get into, especially moms, women who are moms, of like, look at all of the skill sets that you have built during this time. Holy cow. This is what all of the people who are hiring out there that I talk with and that I interact with, these are the skill sets that they're all looking for. Like, this is what they all want to have. And it's so interesting then, like, how do we build that bridge in order to give certification to it? You know what I mean? Like, give some kind of authority to those skill sets that are built when we are in that parenting realm, because it's definitely something that's really, it's really desired right now. I totally agree with that.
Well, it's interesting because the leadership course that we took together, one of its core tenets is that everyone is a leader.
Yeah, I know.
Right. And so if we start there, if we start with everyone is a leader, then we can all embrace our leadership skills in whatever role we decide to apply them against, right? Some of us will apply them at home. Some of us will apply them in our community. Some of us will apply them in our companies. Some of us will apply them across all of those, right?
Yeah.
And so I think if we start with the internal belief within ourselves that we are truly leaders, we are truly developing our leadership throughout our life, well, then we can come from that place no matter what we're applying it against.
Yeah. I so agree with that. So we kind of talked about this before we jumped on, that I personally, to a certain degree, because of this story that's being told out there and exactly what you pointed to, I really like to talk about the motherhood leadership style. That it is actually a leadership style, and it's not just anything. Although I'm totally trying to like bring this in. I'm like, yeah, that's right. I'm just a mom. That's all I am. You know, what does that mean? What are the stories that we say? Because every person that I talk to at some point says, I'm just a something. And so I'm trying to be like, okay, we're going to reframe that. We're going to own that and see what that actually means. And I think that probably the leader that I like to think of the most in terms of that motherhood leadership style is Mother Teresa. And we were talking about this a little bit before. I think it's so fascinating that we always call her mother. She always comes as Mother Teresa. She is not Sister Teresa. She's not just Teresa. She's always Mother Teresa. And she never had any physical children. And I think that she's like this beautiful image of the embodiment of that motherhood leadership style that I think is so valuable actually in all of these areas of the world. And definitely something that I aspire to in my leadership too.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at leadership in general, and you look at some of the research around just what's the difference between an exceptional leader and your everyday kind of, let's say, manager, or I don't even know what the opposite of that would be, but you get what the distinction I'm trying to make. It's all of the things that we do as leaders. Being empathetic, being able to see the strengths of other people and develop that, nurturing people so that they are the best that they can be, having a vision for the future and communicating that vision, having to juggle all of these different things that come our way and somehow emotionally regulate ourselves so that we're some kind of steady in the storm of motherhood and parenthood, right? Those are critical skills. That is the difference between an exceptional leader and a mediocre leader, right? It's all of those things that are, I'd almost say, demanded of us as mothers. Yes. Because of just the circumstance that we're in when we're parenting, yeah. Right? And so I love that they call Mother Teresa, Mother Teresa, because I think it gives, it elevates and it really, not, it gives the respect to the word mother that it should. And I think in society, and especially in potentially the corporate world, we might not elevate it to the extent that it actually needs and should be, right? And so I love that they call Mother Teresa, Mother Teresa, because it speaks to the value and to the worth that that role actually plays in our society, not only in the sense of preparing the next generation, which, you know, we parents certainly do, but in terms of what's actually required of us as parents, what are we called to do in that role, right? And so, I love that you bring that up. And the sun's always in my eyes. I apologize.
I know, I love it. It's awesome. You know, I have to say, it makes me almost cry when you say that kind of stuff. And to hear that from someone that I so admire. And I look at women who are these part-time moms and then part-time something else. And I have so much admiration for that and seeing that juggling act and that place that women who've chosen to do that are in. And it is, I don't know, we women are being so ridiculous right now, in my opinion, because we're like crashing up against each other and we're not supporting each other in these two different, we just chose differently, you know, or we even just chose differently for like a few years, you know, and we're I feel like we're doing this thing where we're not giving each other that respect of that choice and of being like, heck yeah, choose that. Go, you rock it out, sister. Like, more power to you, you know? And I think that there is such space for finding that kind of like atonement and forgiveness and kind of acceptance and togetherness where we're like, we're just gonna link arms and be strong together in this, you know.
I think like in so many things in life, if we appreciate that we are much more alike than we are different, I think we'll come from a place where we can appreciate and value each of our decisions. I wrote a post yesterday about image and how we all create images that we all are trying to live up to. And I think it's time that we let go of those images. We let go of creating some kind of utopia of how things should be and have to be. And we respect that we have light and shadow. We have, we have an opportunity to make decisions based on who we truly want to be rather than an image that someone creates for us, what we think we need to be or want to be, or what the recent magazine tells us we should be, right? Like, if we come from a place of letting go of those and making the decision today that feels right for us and respect that others will do the same for what works for them, and that at the core of all of us, we are so much more alike than we are different, irrespective of the decisions we make. We all love our kids. We all want the best for our kids. We want to be happy and fulfilled. We want to do right by those around us. We all want that. And at the end of the day, isn't that what's important, right?
No, I totally agree. So, okay. So I completely agree with this. And I think that what you just articulated is an image. I think that there is, and this is an image that I am trying to actually put out into the world of this, like, I'm going to cry in front of all of you sometimes. Like, I just am. Why? Because I don't know, because that's what real humans actually do. And don't we all cry sometimes about stuff, you know? So, yeah. For me, like, I hear what you're saying about the image thing, and it has been useful for me throughout my whole life to find people that I admire and to work towards that almost to a certain degree. You know what I mean? And image was always a big part of that for me because it helped me to concretize it. It's like when we visualize stuff in our heads, it makes it more concrete, you know? And so I would really visualize that. And so I think that something that it seems like you're pointing to is we're all so much more complicated than any one image that we could ever put out into the world. We have so many different facets to ourselves, which is so cool. And I think that I feel like we're going to be visual human beings for at least some time longer. And so for me, it's like, okay, so what is that I want to put out in the world? Well, I want to put out this complex image. I want to put out one where, yes, I wear my superwoman boots and I go into those, like, you know, tough spaces and do the leadership development there. Yeah, I'm a mom. Yeah, I'm a runner and I'm going to cry about stuff sometimes, you know, like all of this stuff, because we're just so much more complex than just one image that we're projecting out there.
Absolutely. And as long as we're feeling like we're making the choice.
Yeah, I agree with that.
To even try on the boots, right? I don't know what it feels like to put superwoman boots on. I want to try them out.
Yes.
But you're consciously choosing to do that. Great. I think, you know, this is not to mean that we're not going to progress. We're not going to try new things. We're not going to, for sure, all of that's important. I think at the core of it is that we know that it's a choice that we're making and not one that we feel we need to make.
Yes. Yeah, totally. And I think for me, this brings in a lot of the saboteur stuff. And so, and I know, so you did the saboteur training with Shirzad Shamin, right? You went through that. Yeah. And did that. Yeah. So I read the book and we use it in any, I always use saboteur training in the books. So saboteurs are basically these voices that, here, why don't you say, what's your definition of saboteurs?
Saboteur is an inner critic, and they come in a bunch of different forms. Based on Shirzad's research, he's identified 9 of them, and they come in anything from like a stickler who tries to control a lot of things to a perfectionist who needs to be always at the top of her game. There's 9 different ones, and all of us have it. Many people say that it's kind of part of your amygdala limbic system, if we get into the neuroscience of it. And it's the part of you that tries to keep you safe somehow. Doesn't do it in the most self-serving way, but its intentions are
good.
Yeah.
Exactly. I love that. And what I love is that we all have voices in our heads, because that makes me feel better.
We need to accept them and embrace them.
Exactly. There they are. And I love, he has a TED Talk where he talks about how he interviewed some CEOs and had them write down on a piece of paper kind of like their biggest fears. And it is just so interesting, because I think that we put assumptions and images onto other people and think, well, that person's not feeling the way that I'm feeling. They would never feel like a fraud. They would never feel this scared about stuff. They would never feel like maybe they're not living up to what their parents think that they should be, you know, like all of this kind of stuff. And I love that he just like trashes that assumption that we're holding about these kind of authority figures in society, and are like, no, they think it too. Every single one of us thinks those exact same things.
Yeah, there's no one immune to an inner critic. There really isn't. And I have found that sometimes the greater your success, the louder that critic. I believe it was Oprah who said that after every single interview she's ever done, no matter who it's been with, and she has interviewed the most successful people in the world, they always ask her the same question. Was that okay? And what they want to know is, was I good enough?
Yes.
Like, what, you know, that's what they want to know. So it, those things that as mothers sometimes, and we think, oh, like that inner critic, like, am I enough? Am I doing it? Everyone has it, no matter what they have accomplished, succeeded, these external accomplishments. We all have that inner critic. Nobody is immune to it. It's interesting. I heard, I think this is a Rich Lippmann thing, but many people have said it before, which is, you know, we compare how we feel on the inside with how people look on the outside. And it certainly is not a fair comparison.
Yes. It's so true. And, you know, it's so interesting for me that you brought this up, because I feel like you and I bonded over the saboteur voices that we have in our heads about motherhood, about being mothers, and that we were both like, oh my gosh, I have no idea what I'm doing here. And it's so interesting, because I think that is that place that we can go of like common humanity. I think that for us women, especially in society, and then eventually women and men in society too, that like, we just kind of start somewhere, that for us women, that we could really come together there, and for women who are not physically mothers, who embrace that mother leadership style like Mother Teresa did, because they have children too. It's just in a different way. It's an amazing way. And so finding that sort of common humanity that's there of like, I don't know what I'm doing. I really am trying my hardest, because I love them with every part of my being, and I see how amazing they are. And that's what I'm going to pour into, you know, every part of me is going to pour into that.
I love that you're saying that, because I think that's the answer to so many challenges that we have as mothers, as leaders. It's just to really open ourselves up and share our heart and let people know that we're all just trying to figure it out. We're all just trying to do the best that we can. And whether you decide to be a full-time mom, full-time parent, or continue to work, those are still the same, and we still have very similar challenges, I would say, I think. So I love that you're saying, I love that idea of just opening ourselves up to share what it is that we're personally feeling challenged about, because that is how you and I really connected, I think, was just say, hey, listen, I'm trying to figure it out. And you're like, yeah, me too.
Exactly. And then I think it's really cool, because then I think that there's also this space of, especially for women who, like me, if they chose to be full-time moms and then decide that they want to shift careers and be part-time moms, part-time something else, and or women who chose to be part-time moms, part-time something else, and through circumstances, which some are happening right now, are then being pushed into that full-time mom thing, of the sharing. There is just so, I mean, like the sharing of, you know, me being able to talk to you and be like, so how is it with project management, you know, or like, how do you do some of the like more business sort of stuff, sort of like some mentorship there and advice that's there that's possible. And I think that that helps to create this growth through the lattice. And then the other way around too, for women who then are, you know, did the part-time and are now into this full-time of like, how did you legit manage to not kill yourself while you were raising children? You know, like, how did you do, what did you do? And I'll be like, naps. You have to make them take naps always. It just doesn't matter all the time. Yeah. But I think there's so much like of that sharing through the lattice. And when we do that, it creates such opportunities where we can kind of weave back and forth with each other.
Yeah, we can absolutely learn from each other. And I think that starts with what you've already said, which is just a respect for each of our decisions, right? And that we all bring skill sets to the table. Because we truly do. We all do, right?
Yeah,
and exactly. We all learn from each other.
Yeah, exactly.
For sure.
So, yeah. I feel like this is like actually that this is like the point of the feminist revolution of like, it doesn't matter what choice you make. Just that's your choice. It's okay. Go make that choice. That was your choice. Whatever. Like there's no judgment around that choice, and that we have the ability to make those choices now.
Yeah. And I think we have to respect the choice that we make, accept it and embrace it.
Yeah.
And then agree that we all have the right to make our own choices and respect the choices that others make as well. Because who am I to say what is right for someone else? And who is someone else to say what is right for me, right? And so many of the times we make a choice and then we need to determine whether it's still the right choice. It's not something that you live forever with. Right? Because sometimes you kind of say, oh, you kind of categorize yourself as, oh, this is the type of choice I'm going to make. Well, but you can make that choice and decide that it's not working for you. And it's totally fine to change course after the fact as well. I think we need to be open to that as well. Because you don't, when I first had my first child, I didn't really know. I kind of went with my gut and then it was working for me. So I continued down that road until one point where, you know, it wasn't working for me any longer and I made a different choice. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to realize that we don't have to make that one choice once and then live with it either.
Yeah. That's beautiful. That is such a beautiful pointing. And I think something that's so important here in this space. And I think that it's something that as soon as we women and men too find complete acceptance in exactly what you're saying, society will change because we actually make up society. And so like, if we're like, hey, I can do this for a time and then I can do this other thing for a time and then I can do this thing for a time and then I can, you know, our world will sort of change and adapt to be like, yeah, that's totally true. Absolutely. Because we're the ones who actually make up our world.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Yeah. The other thing that I've noticed is especially with parents and moms, is that we're awfully hard on ourselves. Yeah. Whether we're stay-at-home moms or whether we're working moms, we are really hard on ourselves and we carry a lot. Like we just carry it all, right? We're managing so many different details. We're holding space for so many different people. We're keeping so many people kind of together. We hold so much. And so if there was one message that I kind of wanted to leave both working moms, stay-at-home moms, and everything in between, is that just be kind to yourself. You know, embrace what we perceive as failings. Just embrace them. It's okay. We all make them.
Oh my God.
We're all juggling.
All the time. Right?
And so if there was a commonality between, it's just an appreciation for how big a role this is. Mm. What a beautiful opportunity for leadership it is. Mm. And to accept that we're all just trying to figure it out and to be kind. Because it's a lot. It's a lot.
Definitely. Yeah. Yep. And that, I think, is a beautiful note on which to end in. So thank you so much. I really actually could continue having this conversation for a really long time. So thank you for joining us for this time. And I know that you're a coach. I think that you have a pretty full plate at this point. And if people want to get to know more about you or have a conversation with you or anything like that, where can they reach out?
My website, lisadarocha.com. So I'm sure we'll put it on the,
yeah,
the spelling, yeah, of that, because that's not always the easiest.
Yeah, class. Exactly. Yeah.
But that will be able to get right in contact with me through there.
Awesome. And Lisa,
thanks so much for having me, Carmen.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks for joining. And yeah, we'll have to do this again. So thanks. Okay. Bye.